All right, so let's get started with our tutorial today. So I'll be taking you through steps to run AIR3D. It's a computational tool to calculate blast loading of structures. Till now, you've been using softwares like LS-DYNA or Abacus or charts, big charts to calculate the reflection pressure on a structure, like calculate impulse loading and everything. But now we would use AIR3D. It's a computational fluid dynamics based code. So it uses physics. It doesn't use empirical formula derived from experiments. It was developed as Cranfield University at UK as a part of the thesis of one of the students. And so what you can get, so you have to remember your mind, this can only be used to get the pressure history. So you can only get the loading for your blast engineering calculation, and in that you can get pressure, you can get density. So density is changes also along the as shock wave progresses. Then you can get the internal energy at any point. You can get the velocities of the shock wave in three directions. You can also get the temperature. So that's pretty neat. Now, regarding the advantages and disadvantages of it, advantages are mainly it doesn't have a user interface, so it's very computationally efficient because it doesn't contain all the bulk that comes with the all other user interface softwares. So what it does, it takes an input file as a text file, and then it does the 1D analysis, then 2D, then 3D, and then progresses like that. So it's very computationally efficient. You just have to provide a text file, 50, 55 KB, something like that. Now, main disadvantages people might think is there's no graphical user interface. So you cannot actually visualize structure. If you have a complex structure, you cannot actually analyze with this one. Now, it is basically limited to rectangular structure. So if you have a building that's rectangular, and it can only analyze structure that are perpendicular to one of the Cartesian coordinates. So your structure has to be perpendicular to either x, y, or z-axis. You can only use constant cell size in space. So you cannot, like in Abacus, LS-DYNA, what you do, you provide, like you have ability to provide differential mesh size, different mesh size at different points depending upon how much accuracy, or if there's like convergence problem near a contact or anything, something like that. Now, it can only be used. Now, you would be wondering about the name AIR3D. So it's only applicable to air. So you can only use with a constant specific heat ratio of gamma equal to 1.4. That's for air. That's why it's called AIR3D. Yes. Yeah. That
Even you can input a specific heat ratio, but instead it's going to work with 1.4.
Yes, only for that, because then it can use the conventional equation of states. We read in our notes. If you use to some, I mean, there are successor of this software which I think have capability to do that. I'm not sure it's called, I think it's called ProS Air, but this one, what we are doing today, it can only analyze a specific constant specific heat ratio. Now, execution. So how do we run this? I'll be taking you through the steps, but just as an introduction. Input is not graphical user interface. So you prepare a text file where you provide all the information of your structure, your charge weight, your domain, and your loading conditions. And then you run AIR3D.exe. That's the main file through which you run the analysis. Now, your output are in the binary format, .bin format. So you use v9.hist_history_reformat.exe for formatting bin files to CSV files, which you can use for plotting graphs or doing other post-processing work. Then you have history.reduce. So if you want to get the peak values, so if you want to get the peak values, there's another exe, this .exe file that you would need to run. Now, there are many others .exe file depending upon what kind of post-processing work would you like to do, and your folder would have that. But today, these are the only three or four things that we would need to do in order to get the desired result for our loading. So let's go through the example. This is the example that we did, and our well, the results of this analysis you used in your fourth assignment, where you used the loading history, and the loading history was obtained from this one analysis from AIR3D. Now, depending upon your mesh size, depending upon how you define your problem, you might get different answers, you know, because this is actually sensitive to mesh, which I would be showing to you, like, you know, with the help of different results. So as you remember, this is an I-beam of height 5 meters, and it is from like 3 meters from the charge, and the charge is like hemispherical burst on the surface. So you have density, like typically TNT density is taken as 1.6 into 10 to the power 3 kg per meter cube. Radius is calculated as, well, I mean, you can, this is just the weight, and weight would be like, you know, four, I mean, this is the volume of the, it's considered as a sphere. The charge is considered as a sphere, and then you multiply that volume with density, so you get weight. Using that expression, you can calculate what is the radius of charge if you have the weight of charge and the density of charge, which comes out to be around 0.42 meter. Now, so what it does, so you have problem definition in one dimensional, two dimensional, or three dimensional. Now, usually if you want to do a 3D analysis, you first do a 1D, I mean, you provide information of 1D analysis. So if you have information along the x-axis, just one dimensional, what it does for doing two dimensional analysis, there is a internal remapping technique that it uses. So it takes the information from one dimensional analysis and then project it in two dimensional analysis. That's a technical thing that I don't think that really concern us, unless you really want to go into it, I mean, develop it rather than be a user of it. And then from two-dimensional information, it constructs a three-dimensional mesh. So the best way to do is go through the input file and go through the each line one by one. It's not very difficult. It's the short file, and I would as I go through it, it would give you what are the parameters that are needed. So let's go through it. Now, as you know, the exclamation mark, it represents comment section. So we will start with the spherical input, which is basically a 1D. So it's along the radius, so it's one dimensional part of the file. What do you do? So your first line, you provide density of the charge, which is the default values. Now, most of the things that is here, so they are information are already given. You would only need to change very few things in order to proceed with your analysis, mainly on the definition of where your structure is, and what your charge distance is, and what the mesh size you would like to use. So the first is, what is the explosive definition? You have density, that is 1.6 to 10 to power 3. Then you have energy, this is the specific energy, that is standard to TNT, and then the detonation velocity. So they would be pretty much standard among, for all your analysis. This is just reference, people who actually developed this and where this example was taken from. So what you do, as I said, two dimensional analysis take the information from one dimensional analysis. So this is the this is the result of one dimensional analysis that would be written on this file. This has an extension of S to signify that this is a spherical input output for one dimensional analysis. .tnt is your basically extension of that file. Now, charge mass definition. Now, remember, because your charge mass is on surface, you have to double your charge weight. So we had a 500 kg, if you remember, 500 kg charge mass, because it was on the surface and we cannot model the charge below the surface, you have to double it so that all the response parameters, they are consistent with the charge mass that is on the surface. So if you have a hemispherical charge mass, you double the charge mass, remember that in mind. Then, you provide the radius. So this is the radius of your domain. If you remember, we had a 3 meter standoff distance. So this is not the radius of the charge. Now, delta R is your mesh size that you would like to use. Now, how do you calculate this mesh size? Initial mesh size, you can come up with this formula right here. Not this one, but using this same equation, you can calculate delta R, and depending, I think the standoff distance, this is calculated corresponding to a standoff distance of 1.2 kg per meter cube. So basically this is like a trial and error. You would start with, depending upon capability of the machine you are using, you would start with a certain delta, but the initial recommendation is that you start with a standoff distance corresponding to 1 into 10 to the power 3 kg per meter cube. Now, you have problem time. This is the time for which you would like your analysis to run. Now, you would need to estimate what this could be, because you don't want your analysis to be running for like, you know, very long time, because then it would take a long time to finish that analysis. So what you do, you come up with this problem time of 10 milliseconds. If you remember, if you calculated from the charts, we have a like we had a positive phase duration of around 3 to 4 milliseconds. So I'm starting with 10 milliseconds. It's a good estimate. You can change it if you see your analysis is not finishing up by that time. Then you have CFL. Well, this is a parameter that controls the convergence. So usually this is left additives. You don't have to worry about that. Now execution flag, whether you want your one dimensional analysis to run, or like, you know, so your one dimensional analysis would run, then two dimensional, three dimensional. If you want your one dimensional analysis window, the display window, to close after that, use true. If you don't want it to close, let it remain there on your desktop, just use false. Now display increments. So as I told you, in the output, you can actually get between different cycles, you can get like, you know, how the shock wave is proceeding. So if you want that to display on here, this is what it does, that this specifies the start time of that, and then after how many cycles you want every window to appear. This is like calculation cycle, computational cycle. So if you want after every 10 computational cycle, it can, you can do that. We will see like, you know, how it goes in your now the plot variable. So what you would like to plot, if you would like to plot a variation of pressure or temperature, this is what it does, and it's written in the manual that what the different options available to you. Now if what we are doing, we are not plotting anything from the 1D analysis, so we'll just use one, and we'll use the false. So we are also not printing any bitmap files, the image files. We will do that for the three-dimensional analysis, because that's what we ultimately want. Now the target points. So this is the monitoring point that you have to define. Now if you have to get a response history, not the response history, pressure history, whether it's reflected pressure history or incident over pressure history, at certain point in your domain, this is where you define it. So you define how many number of points you want. Well, for this case, we don't want anything from 1D analysis, so just zero, and start from one. This is if you had any point defined, then you would have started like, you know, and defined the location of different points, but since for this one you don't want anything, we are not going to define. No format is just saying if you want your results to be formatted or not. Once your analysis finished, it automatically formats your results. And what do you want? Now we want static pressure. Now you know there are two kind of pressure, static pressure and dynamic pressure, right? But for the blast loading history and the pressure reflection over pressure history at a monitoring point, it is mainly dominated by static over pressure history for the loading. So that's what you want. So we'll specify. If you want, you can provide dynamic X as well, X, Y, Z in three directions, and you can do that. That finishes up our 1D analysis, input for 1D analysis. Now let's go to the 2D analysis. So what it does, we have already provided all the information regarding charge, weight and everything right here. So in this one, that would be just additional, like, you know. Now this is the output file. See, this is the subscript with subscript R that signifies radial input, radial output, and height of the burst problem, because our charge weight is at the surface, right? The height of the burst problem would be zero. We didn't provide that in 3D analysis because it was like, you know, 1D analysis, so you could not provide height basically. So height of bust is 0.0. Now the cell size here, we had chosen how much? 2 mm here. We are choosing 5 mm here. A general thumb rule is, if you're providing a cell size of X mm for the 1D analysis, provide more than double for the 2 dimensional analysis, right? So I started with 5 mm. You know, again, it's a trial error thumb rule. Take more than half, double, and proceed with that. Then I provided R max as 3 mm again, 3 meter again. That was our standoff distance. So that's the domain of the problem. Now in this case, because it's a two-dimensional problem, we also can define the height of the domain. So you have to define domain of the boundary in x direction, y direction. Now, remember, our height of the column was 5 meter, right? So you would like to provide the domain more than that, so that it can capture. If you provide boundary at 5 meter, you would have to provide whether it's a reflective boundary and whether it's a transmissive boundary, you know. So that might include some error. So what do you do? I provided like 10 meter double of that, so the boundary effect doesn't come into play due to that. You can go for 15 meter as well, 6 meter as well, up to you, but it should be it should be larger than your problem, like the obstruction structure, in this case the beam. So that's that. Now once you do that, you have to provide boundary conditions. Like any other software, you have to provide where your boundaries are. Now there are two boundary conditions. One is transmissive boundary condition, let the waves pass, so it doesn't stop the wave right there. Reflective boundary condition, it stops the wave and the calculation of waves above that. So you have, if you want your if you don't want a transmissive boundary, if you want a reflective boundary condition, provide -1. If you want a transmissive boundary, provide +1. So as you can see, because we don't care what happens, like, you know, after the beam, we want the loading in front of the beam, right? So we provided reflective boundary conditions -1 near the beam, and along the height we provide transmissive, so we let the wave pass. Now the program control, so again we have to define a problem time, like, you know, for how much time you want your analysis to run, and then whether you want your analysis window to close after the analysis finish, or whether you want to remain there. So you can provide, like, you know, 10 millisecond. Again, I provided false, so I would let the window there. Now switching factor is something when you want your analysis to switch from one dimensional to two dimension. Usually it has default value of 1.0. you don't change it, just let it be there. And like in the last case, we used a switching factor, a CFL. This was a convergence factor. We use 0.75 for two dimensional analysis. We use 0.5. So these are the things that you don't make any changes. Execution flag true, because you want to run this analysis. Now the plot option. So in this one, you have a plot option 2. What it means, that it will plot contours and not the XY curve. So this the manual that I provided to you, it will have that information, different plot options available to you. And then the plot variable 1. Well, plot variable 1 basically says that draw contours of the pressure history. So one correspond to pressure. Now if you want white background or not, if you want to present it in a report, it's like sometimes useful to use white background. And then the display increment, again you start with time 0.0 and you display after every 100 second. These are the things that you need to provide, IXY. So all these line, if you provide plus option 1, if you provided 2, this thing doesn't matter that much. It doesn't matter at all if you provide the option 2. So 300. Now this factor, so you would see, like, you know, contours. In contours you have range of values, right? To like in an LS Dyna, you have if you have a strain from 0 to 100, you divide it in 0 to 10 or 10 to 20, like, you know, to show the resolution, how bad, like, you know, what's the relative magnitude. So you can play with this right here factor to get like appropriate resolution in your plots. Now bitmaps, you don't want any images from there, from 2D analysis to video, so you put false. Now the obstacle definition, so in this case in two dimensional you can define obstacle like as I said, for rectangular structure in three dimensional case. So for two dimensional case it would be basically either a square, a circle, a wedge, a triangle, something like that, right? Now we are not defining any obstacle for two dimensional analysis, so we will just leave there. We define our obstacle definition through the help of node number and their coordinates between these two lines, begin obstacle and end obstacle. And then the target points, again this target points is the point at which you want to monitor your pressure history or other parameter history, and what do you want to monitor and in what format. So again it's the same like the last time. Now let's go to the main. So you provided input for 1D analysis, you provided input for 2D analysis, you would always have to provide that. Then you come with the main input, that's your 3D analysis. So we would start with, this is the origin of remap. So this is not actually the origin of the charge center. So what do you want? You want your origin to be at 000. It's up to you, you can define anywhere. But usually it's like, you know, it's better if you define it at the origin, because then you would have a better perspective of different locations. Now if you put a charge weight on ground, the center of charge weight would not exactly be zero, right? It would be a certain height, very small height, but it does not matter because it's the origin of remap, so you can define it 000. Now the domain definition, like in two dimensional case, we had used, in that case we had used 5 mm, in this case again you use double the quantity or 10 mm. Now I have tried in my analysis different cell sizes, 10 mm, 20 mm, 24 mm, and investigated the mesh sensitivity, what the effect of mesh size on your response parameters. But on this today, although this is stage 10, I would show you the results for 24 mm, because considering the time we have right now, like, you know, we can only see results for that one. It takes some time to get the results if you have mesh size very small. Now X min and X max, again defining your X boundary. So now remember, in this case we're defining a three dimensional boundary, so our standoff distance was 3 meters, but I'm taking a little further than 3 meters, as 5 meters, just to capture, like, you know, what happens after the beam as well, so it will show you that. And then in y direction, 0 to 1 mm. Now I'll show you where are these points located. And then z direction, the height, it was only 0 to 5, I provided from 0 to 6. Again I provide reflective boundary in one at one end and the transmittive boundary at the other end. So all the boundaries at the origin are provided reflective because they are center of symmetry. Others are provided, like, you know, others are provided transmissive, so let the wave pass. Now program control, problem time, I have used 5 milliseconds because I know from trial and error my analysis stops before 5 milliseconds, so I've used that. You can start with a larger time, you know, I decreased the time because my analysis was creating, like, you know, it was taking a long time if I provided a large. Switching fog factor, default value 1.0, again CFL default value, you don't have to change this very often. Now plotting parameters, again I discussed you, if you want contours, plot option 2, plot variable, pressure history, white background, yes I want it, and then display increment, I want them after every 50 cycle. Then the scale factor, I have established after trial and error that 300 was a good measure to get an appropriate resolution. This you don't have to worry about if you're using a plot option 2. Now are it gives you the option whether you want to use right hand rule or not. Well, in this case I'm not using that, I'm just using whatever it has inbuilt. Then do I want bitmaps plotted? Yes. VRML flag is basically, it shows you the structure in 3 dimension, we'll see that how it looks. Obstacle, so this is your obstacle definition, so this is basically the structure that you define. Now you have your beam there, so you basically, what we do for the beam, you have the surface at which the wave strike, So at that surface, and it doesn't matter if it's an I-beam or rectangular beam for analysis purposes, right? And because it can, it's much easier to model an I-beam in an I-beam as a rectangular beam here. I've used a rectangular structure here to get that. So I provide the definition. It was the total height of the I-beam was 0.416 around. So I took the first x-axis, starts as my standoff distance 3. It goes up to 3.416. Then along the y direction, you know, width of the flange, and then along the height. So, and you define, if you define false, what it does that it says to Air3D, you have cells at these locations in which it's a solid and it's not air. So false is just to signifies that it's solid and not air. So you have to treat it like that. You end obstacle, so you define your structure between begin and end obstacle. Then, now these are the things that I think you remember when we were discussing in the class, window and average pressure regions. So these are for PI elements like windows, you know, failure elements like pressure, impulse elements. Well, we don't have to worry about that because we're not gonna be using that. Now the target points. So you have all these monitoring target points. I don't know whether you remember, if you go back, yeah, right here. So I basically provided all the location of these target points right here. Okay, so you basically have to provide coordinates of these target points. If you see what I have done, I have modeled only half of this beam. If you see here, so this is my how the model in 3D, Air3D looks like. Right, you have a charge weight here, and then half of the charge weight. This is only the half of beam. So this is the middle points at the middle center of the, at the center of the beam. So you can see your monitoring locations here. Why I have done that? Because it has a central symmetry. If you use that, it reduces the computational cost by a lot. If you would like, you can go for full-fledged structure. Doesn't matter if you have that much of computationally. Don't mind computational work, you can go for that, but I've just used the symmetric part, you know. So it's not a mandatory, but it's a good practice. That's all. So as you can see, this you can define. Now we will be doing the actual analysis. So what we do, let's go here. So if you go to a folder, the folder that I gave you, so I've basically done for 24 mm mesh. This is the file that I have provided all my inputs in. Where is it? Let's see. Yeah. So what I discussed basically is right here in this text file. All right. Not a big text file. You have different files as well. You have a file name 00 underscore global cell size. If you provide this, so this is for one dimensional case, the cell size, this is two dimensional, this is three dimensional. Now remember, you had already given that in your input file. If you write 000 here, what it does, it takes the default, like take the values that you have previously defined your input. If you provide some finite value here, I mean non-zero value here, then it takes this value, override the previously value that you defined in your text file and takes these values. All right. Input file has the 00 input file has the name of the input file. Our name of the input file was column height 5 meter, 500 kg was the charge weights, this one, and input file defines that one. Now there are other files as well. So these files, basically you don't have to do any modification. I'm just showing you so that you know what are these files for. You have number of processors. Well, it was for my old machine which has 8 processor. I think this one has only 4 processors, so I'll change it to 4. So this is the number of cores you want to use in your analysis. I'm using 4 cores, so I'll just use 4. And these are the files that are generated. They are there because I had generated them from previous analysis. You can probably delete them to avoid any confusion. So what do you do? You don't have to do anything. Once you define your all your input file and define these three files, you just need to run this one, Air3D underscore version 9. I don't know what these two other files are for. I never use them. I just use this one. So you just click, double click on this one. That's it. Your analysis will start running. So let's see what happens. So this is from one dimensional analysis. These are the blast wave, I think, from our two dimensional analysis. So you can see how the blast wave is progressing. Right. And the contours, they will come right here. I mean, this is a slow laptop, but it will come right here. It will show you, like, you know, what this different pressure means, what are the relative magnitude. But it gets really interesting. Once you get into three-dimensional analysis, you can actually see how the blast wave interacts with your structure, which is kind of very neat, right? Let me check if this is still recording or not. Yes, it is. All right. Yeah, so once this analysis finishes, it will go into three-dimensional analysis. See, it will give you all the values, right? It will also give you the problem sign. This is, I think, is this initiations of a three-dimensional. This is the time zero. So the right legend here, it will show you everything. What the problem time is, what the finish time is, and how much time has progressed, what the analysis is, and this is the contours. Now see, the limitation of this window that it cannot show you more than 32 kPa, but if you remember, our maximum pressure went up to 61 GPa, right? Yeah, it was much more than 32 kPa because you used a scale factor of 300. It cannot show more than, if there's, like, you know, more than 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 digits. So that's fine, you know, but you know, like, you know what the range is. All you want to know is the relative magnitude. So you can see your problem has run only for 0.82 milliseconds. The total problem time is 5 milliseconds. Completion is 16%, and it will show you how much time it has taken and everything. So I have made it to refresh after every 50 because this computer is slow. Computation cycle is, like, you know, it takes more time, so it will refresh after that many cycles. So you can see the values now. Let it run it like that, and we can come to now. What it'll do? See, you have already a plot generated. We remember. See. So what it does, after every 50 cycles, it takes a screen capture of this window that we were running, and it saves a plot here. See, there's another plot generated, right? So it will keep on generating that and saving that because you had provided that option in your input file, right? After the analysis finishes, it will also generate you the bin file, .pressure.bin file, which contains the information of pressure history at your monitoring points, right? If you run this exe that we discussed, what is that? Let's see, v9 history dot underscore history dot underscore reformat, it will reformat your .bin files to .csv file, and it will give you result. We will plot that. Now let us come. So how do you know whether it is monitoring the incident over pressure history or whether it is monitoring the reflected over pressure history? Because at the same point, located at the same point, you can monitor both, right? Yeah, there need to be a way to differentiate that. How you do that is by going to your text file. Let's go to the back to the presentation. Now, these monitoring points, so I've defined my monitoring points. Now, if you define your monitoring points on the surface of your obstacle, or in our case, the column, it will record the reflected overpressure history. But if you define just before that, it will monitor, which makes sense, right? It's according to the physics. It will monitor the incident overpressure history, right? So up to you. Like what you want to monitor. You can also monitor impulse or temperature or internal velocities or anything. And that's how you do it. Let's see how far our analysis is proceeding. So I think this is the second window. Right. So see, this is the third image generated as well. So the images will keep on generating. Don't provide, like, you know, if you provide, like, you want your window to generate files after every five computational cycle, it will populate your directory and make it really big. Each file is like, you know, each I think bitmap file is like 8 MB, I think, or 4 MB, yeah, 4 MB, yes. So provide it, like, you know, I mean, you don't get much information after every five cycle anyway. So you can learn this thing by trial and error. All right, I mean, if I would like, I can go at any point and exit it, stop this analysis, you know. Now in this case, you see, so do you see the yellow region, the highest pressure region is right here. I think it has started to form that max surface. You have a reflection wave from surface going upwards, and it will keep on going till it engulfs the whole column. And now you have wave formation in the back as well, starting in the back. So now it has reached back of the column. Right. So if you want, I can just stop this analysis right now, and I can show you how, like, it will still give me some results, and I can plot that for you. But let's just exit this analysis right here. Okay.
If you exit it, it will just save whatever you have up to the point you exit.
Yes. So if you exit your analysis, it will save up to that point. It's not like other software that it doesn't save anything, you know. So it will save up to that point, which I don't know whether you can see right here or not. So let's go. Let's search for the file pressure.bin. Should be somewhere. I think this is the file pressure.bin. Now, if you use v9 history underscore reformat, let's see what happens. See, you get these pressure files right here for all the monitoring points. Remember, we have 10 monitoring points. We have 10 monitoring points. So we have 10 pressure files. If you go and open them, I think you need to do from first text to columns. All right. So you can plot these values. Insert. See? You have already got the peak of that value, and it's going up to this one. So we ran our analysis only up to this point, right? If you would have run and finished the analysis, it would have gone up to the end. So you can do this for all other points to you. What I will do, I will show the results from the analysis that I did as part of my report. Now, yeah, one another thing. If you go here, and remember we discussed about history reduce, if you click this one, it will give you a results file. But I think it only, let me check. Yeah, see, it gave you a results file right here. Again, you need to convert it from text to columns. First column is the x coordinate of that monitoring point, second is your y coordinate, third is your z coordinate. This one is your maximum value of reflected overpressure or impulse or whatever you are monitoring of that history. The value after that is, I think, is the arrival time. It's given in the manual that I provided you. The third one, I think, is the positive phase duration. Fourth one, I think, is the impulse. And fifth one, it's looks something weird, but because I think analysis has not finished, the last column is weird, but your analysis has this format of this table, that what values correspond to what, so you would know. Now let me just show you some results that I had, and just to put this in perspective. All right. Maximize it. Anyway, let's basic things. Let me just go through the results. All right. So I did many mesh sizes because I had time. You can do too if you have it. I did 10 mesh size 10. Now this was the limit of my machine. You know. It took really long time to do a 10 mm. You can go up to, I mean, you can do like, you know, smaller mesh as well. But keep in mind, one of my conclusion was that it is sensitive to mesh size. So if you have a better machine, use smaller mesh size, as with any other software. Smaller mesh size give you better results. So these are the results that I had generated. I'll show you as a graph, how do they compare. Let's go to this one. So the location, I monitored location 1, location 6. They are different. Shape is not much different, but the peak value is different. We discussed in the class what are the reasons for this one. These spikes are, if you remember, I think if I remember it correctly, it was because the waves reflected from the ground. They were interacting, you know, at some point. And that's why we observed peak. These are the location. So see the values here is around. Yes. So this is around how much? 65 MPa. If you remember, we discussed about that scale factor that it could only capture up to 32 MPa. So we had to use a 300 scale factor to get all the resolution that we wanted. Now see effect of different mesh size, 10 mm, 16 mm, 24 mm, 32 mm, right? See, the overall history does not change that much. It almost remains same. But look at these peak values. It changes significantly. It changes for a coarser mesh size, a value just below 60 to a value above 70, which is a lot, because many of your design would depend upon that peak value. You know, they just consider the peak value, construct a triangle, and analyze it. So this would matter. I mean, if you have a better machine, use it. Now, what I did, I also plotted the mesh sensitivity along the height of the column. Or you can say standoff distance would also change along the height. So you have different peak pressure here, 0, 20. You have height of the column, so we had a 5 meter. You see at the top height where the standoff distance was large, changing mesh size did not change the peak pressure values much. But at the lowest point of the column, as you go along the height, mesh sensitivity it increases. So you have large differences in values due to mesh size. Or you can say, if the standoff distance is larger, effect of mesh would not be that much. But if the standoff distance is smaller, effect would be there. Also, because I think it's because as you go along the height, you have interaction from the waves that are reflected from the ground. So, and if you have too many things coming into the picture, you have more interactions. I think the computational error will be larger. Along the height, you don't have that issue here. That's what I believe, that I think why it was so sensitive.
But Did you see any conversion from that? I mean, because how do you know to stop in 10 millimeters?
Well, as I said, I stopped at 10 millimeters because I could not go further.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if, but as you can see the difference right here? It's larger, it's smaller, it's again smaller.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you can kind of guess that it is converging towards a value. If you have, like, you know, a very powerful machine, keep going. It would might make a good study to see, like, you know, where, after how many, what is the mesh size at which it converges. And it would depend on your problem, right?
Mm.
So if you have a very, I mean, this was a simple structure, just a column. But if you have a big structure that you are modeling, like a building with lots of windows and stuff, go to the monitoring point. See if the values are converging towards certain value by using a powerful machine. And if it does, then I think you would need to change the mesh size to get that convergent value. These are just a screenshot of what you already saw. And these are a few conclusions that I've already discussed with you. Now look at this comparison that I have made. So at the base of the column, the value from charts, the big charts, is 62. The value of peak reflected pressure is 63.3, which is quite accurate. And one thing that I would let you know, this is the software, Air 3D. It was actually, the results of this one actually validated against an experiment, a small scale blast experiment that was done at that university in collaboration with some other companies. So it's a high confidence software, high fidelity software. I mean, because it has been compared against experimental results, and it showed fair, I mean, in terms of blast calculation, it shows you fairly good accurate results. Mid-high, well, it was, the difference was large but still comparable. As you can see, at the base, good comparison. Again, at the mid-height, comparison was not that good. Arrival time was fairly accurate, 0.8, 0.84, but the positive phase duration, it was different. But know that although it was different, if your impulse is like almost same, it does not matter, right? Because the impulse is the area under the chart, so that's the amount of energy you are imparting your structure. I think the difference in the positive phase duration is basically when your pressure values goes to close to zero, like, you know, it can extend up to a large distance and it will increase your positive phase duration. But if you approximate it, and if your impulse is fairly close, you will still get the same, almost same results. So again, compared with the DoD results, well, it should be the Bix chart or the other DoD document that we had. And the peak reflected of pressure was sensitive to mesh size, but the value, but the history wasn't that sensitive. The pressure history was not that sensitive. The arrival time and positive phase duration, they also did not change. So we saw that the peak reflected pressure changed with the mesh size, right? But the arrival time and the peak, the positive phase duration, it did not change with that. And then sensitivity, it decreases as you go up the height, which we already saw in the last figure right here, that if you go up the height of the column, the mesh sensitivity decreases, or you can say as you increase the strand of distance. So those are the main conclusions. These are a few references that you would like to use, if you'd like to go through that. So fairly simple, right? Not, I don't think Air 3D is that difficult to run. It's more about doing things and figuring it out,
yeah.
Trying different parameters, see what's the effect is. Most of the things you don't have to change, only five, six things that you would need to change. Most of the things are just default values for the analysis, unless you're really doing into the research into it and want to figure it out how do they, I mean, most of the times it's the same. Just change the values that you need to. And running it and obtaining results are fairly simple, right? So do you guys have any other question? If you have the file, like, you can get the folder from him and then you can try it. And I mean, if you'd like to discuss, you can come and discuss with me. Right?
Thank you.
All right, so this finishes our tutorial. So let's start.